Do you want to clap to sync them?
Yeah. Should be good. That's a cool trick. I never would have thought about that. That's what that thing's for.
Yeah.
Always wondered what that's for. Because they write the name of the scene and what it, I just thought it was
well,
for
so
organisation.
The visual is for organisation. Because when you're looking at the footage, you can just go to that first frame and see it. And then the clap is the sync. Yeah.
Oh, that's cool. Well, welcome to Talking Dark Live, our symposium-like event here in the Rainer Hof Gallery of the National Art School. First interview, I guess I'm going to do a welcome to country and acknowledge the traditional owners of this land. This is, was, and always will be Gadigal land. Actually, the guy that does the welcome to countries here, Uncle Alan Madden, this awesome old dude, and he, the last couple of years, they've been bringing him out to the Sydney Cricket Test.
Oh, really?
And he gives this great speech, he always ends it with the same joke. And it's just a dad joke. He says, there's an old Aboriginal saying that I think is very appropriate for you, Mob. Where there's a will, there's relatives. And every time, it just kills. Even though we've all heard it a bunch of times.
Yeah.
But it was the greatest thing watching the Sydney Test to see 100,000 people get baited in for the old wise saying.
Right.
And then just to cackle and getting to see them have that experience I had first year at NAS for the first time. And then sure enough, it went viral. his little speech, which was pretty funny. But anyway, into Talking Dark Live.
Did you finish the introduction? Sorry.
Yeah.
Okay.
It was always will be.
Yeah, that's true.
Did that just turn on?
Yeah, I don't know. Was that that light? I guess.
Yeah. Yeah, I never know with the welcome to countries because you hear different ones and I never know which one. I'd like for there to be one standard.
Right.
And like I always hear new things. Or like last year, that sovereignty was never ceded, that came about. And I had to hear that about 20 times before I looked up the phrase.
Mm-hmm.
Just to realise what the wording was. I feel like we all say, sovereignty was never ceded. But like you look at those words and it's like that's not a simple sentence.
Mm.
You kind of need to piece that together to understand what is meaningful. We are here. Thank you for being here. Thank you for helping set all this up. It's been cool. Especially because this paper, this experience of doing my master's has been very autobiographical, and you alongside Nick, our mutual friend, have sort of been around for, a big chunk of that. And perhaps no more context around the stories that are going into my work nowadays, that people who know me professionally are just starting to learn about in bits and pieces. You know, it was that kind of last thing I never thought I'd reach. I never thought I'd get into making videos, even though the videos I make are, pretty shit.
No, they're still films.
Still, still films.
Yeah.
But it really came about because I realised that, I've been in the arts for quite some time now, and community seems to be the thing that's kept me around. With my show, with writing a novel, making an album, but also making a movie, there's this unavoidable thing that you need others to be able to create the work, right?
Mm.
Do you find that driving, or is that a challenge that you're constantly facing with your filmmaking?
Yeah, it's probably a challenge that has pushed me more into animation because I don't have to rely on other people so much. It's kind of the opposite, I guess, for me at the moment. Mm. I'm kind of being pushed away from collaboration just because I'm still interested in developing my skills and my finding what I want to do, and
building the voice.
Yeah, and that's much easier if I don't have to explain it to somebody else at the same time. But probably, especially in film, all the best things and the most interesting things would be from collaboration. So that's what I would need to work back into, to open out into after I've sort of squirreled away, figured out what I want to do first, and then,
Yeah.
I'm not really, I find myself trying to balance between the commercial advertising marketing world of media and the artistic side. So I guess I'm more concerned with that commercial side and not what it means to be an artist. Film's quite different from painting and drawing anyway. I never considered having work that I could sell. So that hasn't been something that I've thought was a possibility. Oh, I can make this and make money through the selling of it. So I guess it's just, I haven't had to consider what an artist is these days, like you do. It's interesting, debates around paying for films and media, because I will torrent whatever and download, and I'm not going to. I don't have some, because I'm working in film. It doesn't give me some moral sense that I should be paying others for their work so that I can, because I want to be paid for mine. If I could just make it and people could watch it without paying, I'd be quite happy. I could just live off government grants, I don't know.
With film, is there a sense that, because I've noticed in talking to, say, Adrian in photography, Matt in advertising, all these things around media, they've all said that the work on the whole is becoming less distinctive in the field. Like there's a kind of a, everyone has specialized jobs and it's all in this kind of corporate structure that's maybe homogenizing everything and smoothing the roughness around the edges. Do you think that applies to filmmaking at all?
I don't think the edges are smoothening. I think the middle probably is, because there's a lot more people in it. And so what we're seeing is just, everybody in film having these small, specific jobs, specific roles, and it's less of an art and more of a craft or
a trade.
Exactly. But especially in animation, it's kind of booming at the moment, and there's so many interesting people doing interesting things. It's just that's only little bits of it get into mainstream media.
Right.
Yeah, get picked up on.
Like we'd probably, we'll see Wes Anderson's movies and written directino and he puts shit out. Wong Kar-wai, there's guys like that. But that's the upper echelon of making a production. There'd be a whole spectrum, right?
There's so many movies being made that it's so hard to hear of them and see them. Yeah, it's kind of crazy. And there'd be lots of guys like those that you mentioned. I just think the big sort of Hollywood commercial side of film, that seems to be homogenizing. And with Marvel, which I wouldn't even classify as film.
Scorsese, I agree with his it's fucking theme park.
Right, exactly. It's kind of, that's so much a business. It almost needs to have a different classification. And it's not like, indie films.
Indie films are just films now.
It's like literature, books. There's so many And as it gets easier and easier, you know, I think you are going to need less people, and so you can have teams the size of, you know, an author, an editor, publisher, working on a film, and it will just be. I mean, you couldn't possibly read all the books that are written each year, and the same for film, same for good film.
Yeah. And I mean, more so now than ever, right? I mean, we were saying the other day, because I mean, tell us just a little bit about this Hong Kong project, because I mean, you're working on it at the moment, but that kind of speaks to that and what you were saying about with your mate and these problems in China and Hong Kong at the moment, and with me and Lisa and her story. There's this just constant content coming out about these things because they're so pressing for a lot of people.
Yeah,
and it's a tough thing to try and find originality in these kind of plights.
Yeah, because he's, you know, a documentary on the Hong Kong protests, and he, you know, he's been stressing a bit over the fact the last 6 months there's been a bunch of documentaries come out about the protests. Larger budgets, and, you know, more established filmmakers. And he's been struggling with, like, what am I offering that's different? Which I'm less stressed than him, partly because it's not my project, it's his, but also because I think from the beginning it's been quite clear that it's a very personal sort of psychological journey and exposition of his experience.
Yeah.
Which is, and from the beginning there's always been this narrative, fictional aspect to it.
This kind of gonzo meeting between the events and his stories.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's funny because it was clear to me from the start that his, the character that he'd sort of created and then filmed in these fictional sections, he never referred to as, like, that's me, that's him, that's himself, his, that's who he was, his role in the film. But it was obvious that that was him.
Yeah.
And I think now he would say that it is him, and he's narrating it, and his but it took a while to get there, which is kind of, I found that interesting.
I mean, it's a funny, like, push and pull, even just bringing it back to what I'm doing here and now is, you know, for so long as an artist and as a musician, kind of all tied into one, there is this constant looking outwards and trying to jump around to avoid everything that's out. When I've kind of found, you know, in the last 2 years, it actually takes all introspection to find that any originality.
Yeah, I'd agree.
Sounds pretty applicable to.
Yeah, I don't think you can work in a way that is trying to look outwards and find the space.
The missing links.
Yeah. That's never going to work.
Yeah.
He just has to do it. It's just a shame that it's, you know, him and me and a couple of others working on it. It just takes so long. And it's like, oh, it'd be good to have this done and out there. That's the hard part.
Hasn't it always been, have you ever found it funny the way, like, inventing as a thing is kind of presented to us? Because that's something I've always found peculiar. Like, in high school, right, in science, you get science tasks, DT tasks, where you have to invent something. And they're always like, do some research and think of something the world needs. Like, think of a gap in, and it's just like, that is so not how it works. And then you go on Shark Tank, and they're all like, you know, I was sitting around in my fucking house one day and realized, you know, I needed these clothes pegs. So it's like, no, that's not how you fucking thought of it. The brain does not assemble things in that kind of way. Like, it's situational. You gotta, you know, it's normally reacting to something.
It needs to be from an art education, the idea of inventing, rather than in the science classes.
Yeah. I mean, I've always maintained that, you know, art making, coming to art school here, it's like, it's almost like I didn't learn art. I sort of knew that shit already. it's more I just learned awareness, just self-awareness. That's all I really got out of this place, which is, you know, invaluable.
And the, I value the university for just the discipline and having deadlines and having to meet certain criteria.
Yeah, like it pushes you along quicker.
Yeah. I think it's very difficult to work just with, you know, open-ended, on your own, no feedback.
I can imagine with films too, like that process must be quite confronting in a way. You're like, what's my next project? Because it's, I mean, in similar vein to this book I'm writing at the moment, it's a big undertaking, and it's like, all right, well, that's going to be my next 18 months.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Like, sayonara.
Yeah. Well, like with the Hong Kong film, Jeremy, you know, living here, and we sort of talked about that or complained about that, like, oh, what? We kind of live fairly mundane, happy lives. Mm. Whereas, you know, what are we making films about? Mm. And then he has that whole experience, and it's just sort of given to him. I mean, it's like a blessing and a curse, the problems that they faced, for Jeremy specifically.
I mean, that's a really good point too, in the fact that, I mean, part of the awareness of being an artist is you can't really go searching for things, can you? It's more you gotta sit there and know which avenue is the one to go down, because I mean, you talk about painting pictures, say, as an example. If I wanted to go out in the field and do some paintings, sit on the train, you know, noticing things outside, by the time I get there, I've got 100 photos on my phone, and there's infinite amount of paintings you can paint.
Right.
But you've got to have that instinct to kind of trawl through that, find the project, mine it.
Yeah. It'd be good if we could just do all the 100 pictures. But it's just so tiring.
Sync it up.
Oh. I don't think we clapped there. Did we clap just then?
We didn't clap for the second one. I'm going to have a bit of a time sync.
You can...
Although we might have gone straight through. I think... I'm not sure if I re-recorded on that or not.
Yeah.
Oh, well.
You just have to watch the lips.
Watch the lips?
If you're going to sync the audio.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I mean, that's how I've been doing it for...
Have you been... Oh, right.
I've had to do it once or twice.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how, I've been doing it.
I find I pick up on audio out of sync quite quickly if I'm watching something.
Something I did want to ask you about with my work was this idea of the way video can operate outside of film conventions, right? Like whereas you are participating in this kind of tradition of filmmaking, my shit seems kind of recent, like I'm pulling from not just podcasting, but remix theory and shit posting, basically.
Well, not even shit posting, it's, you know, content
I think that the aesthetic choice of the, you know, low budget green screen,
right.
That is kind of like emulating the stylisms of
YouTube, basically.
Of YouTube, as a kind of Trojan horse for more complex values, as Luke would say. I've always liked that.
That's cool.
A Trojan horse to kind of slip it in. I mean, that's where the comedy also comes in too. It's just trying to be entertaining to get people listening. It's kind of an inroad to the more serious stuff.
Yeah. I kind of struggled with, like, what... Because I didn't study film, I studied media arts.
Yeah.
And it wasn't like a film education. Mm. You study the classics and history and you learn how to operate on set. None of that. It was a mix of things. Mm. So I feel a little bit the same, like I'm trying to weave my way into that.
Mm.
Yeah.
This guy called Alan Kakro, that's big in my paper, his kind of claim is that non-art is more art than art art. And what he means is, I mean, you read my paper, but there's a lot of things in life that are beautiful and inherently complex, kind of problematic when you try and pass them off as art, you know, whether that's a raw conversation like we're having now, or anything to do with real life, you know?
Well, I mean, I think the artworks in the other room that look like they've been pulled up out of the sea hundreds of years. Yeah, and where if you just did that, in some contexts, you could display that as art, but it's most likely not going to be. But whereas if you make it as a piece, it is.
I really like those counter examples he provided of things that are art, but may present as life shit, like Andy Warhol's recorded conversation, which is probably what this is more like. You know, Walsamer de Maria filling a room full of dirt. I quite like that reading of it because it gives this idea that art is nothing. Like, all art is an organisational framework to throw shit into, which is kind of a freeing thing once you realise it.
Mm-hmm. How do you see the interviews as an artwork or as art?
So I mean, it's funny because it started out with Talking Dark, and what we're doing now, this is kind of me transitioning into making regular content, which was always the goal, but I've kind of fallen in love with the process of making Talking Dark because it's not really a podcast. That feels more like an artwork to me. Like, there's the interview, which is a form of portraiture, but then there's the mixtape, which is collaborated between two people. And then there's all the found video that uses our conversation and their work as a jumping off point. And so it's kind of a convergence of all these different media trying to encapsulate my understanding of my friends. And I think the interesting thing for me in that is that each kind of step of making the show is providing its own insights. Like when you sent me a playlist, that playlist provided information I couldn't retrieve in your interview, and vice versa. And that's kind of become where this video stuff has gone back into the art making, in that I want to make regular content and, you know, start hosting in a more conventional sense, but I also want to keep that kind of more experimental arm of video making, because it also feels, it's quite an intimate experience, right? You came over and we sat there for, you know, 2, 3, 4 hours just talking about your work, and it's interesting to have known, say, you and Nick for a long, long time now, and to still learn new things, and to still realise how hard it is in ordinary life to actually listen intently and not cut people off constantly. It's definitely a trained skill that may be becoming rarer nowadays. Depends where you go and look, I'm sure. I think this is kind of acknowledging that too, in that, you know, yourself included as a main sort of character in all of that. I know so many good people, you know. I just had that many good people around that I hadn't seen you in years. I hadn't seen Nick in even longer than I've seen you. And I was really at a breaking point with that. By the time I started my master's, it was, you know, I had a long-term partner. She left as BFA wrapped up. And yeah, kind of like this last lockdown, it was, you know, too much time by myself in my head. I kind of realized how fundamental you've all been to me eventually coming here. You know, I wouldn't have come here if I wasn't sat on your couch half the time while you were starting up a COFA. You know, I wouldn't have come here if I didn't have experiences with Nick in high school, you know, playing about. So initially I thought I was leaving art to make this sort of stuff. And it's only through the theory, like Capro that I just told you about, like Joseph Boyes with his performance art and social sculpture, that I've come to now consider this as just one part of the art making, which is why there is, you know, copper and paper and different bits and bobs around the place, which I'll address in later interviews.
Well, I like how direct it is as an artwork to your experiences and what you're thinking about and what you're trying to express. But that can be very difficult to nail that down. And you sort of gone, well, I'm just going to speak about it, speak to it. There it is.
Yeah.
And it's like, wow, that's genius. There you go.
Yeah. I mean, it's funny, isn't it? Because that's kind of like, I mean, I'm aware of that. And that is kind of the character I semi-play, but it also has to do with, you know, I've come from rehab before I came here. Like, you knew me through some of the worst times. And once you come out of being so sick for so long, you kind of have to be like that, and you kind of have to just be really upfront and open about things. Otherwise, you're just going to feel like a piece of shit the rest of your life. Like, there needs to be some detachment from what you were to be able to be yourself in the future, and to kind of grow at all. You need to be able to just fucking laugh it off, I think. And I think that's where that all comes from.
As I think it's a very difficult thing to do, to be able to constantly critique yourself, your life.
Yeah.
Even just doing that is kind of an art.
I still struggle with that greatly.
No, I think everybody does.
It's so hard, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's one of the things I took away from the honors year at COFA was, in terms of art practice as research, is like working in practice, and then stepping out of that and trying to look at yourself working and understand what you were doing, what you were thinking, and just, you know, the literal nuts and bolts of it, and that is the research, the just investigating how you go about practice. Yeah, I find that.
That's an important part of Boyes, actually. Joseph Boyes, sorry to cut you off.
No.
But there's this great sense in, so with social sculpture, again, you've read the fucking thing, but for you guys at home, he kind of got out of the Second World War, super depressed, was really struggling with the fact that he was a fucking Nazi pilot, and kind of reinvented himself and created this mythos. And I think in the kind of extended reading I've done into Joseph Boyes, I feel an alike sense of guilt in him. I feel like he felt really, despite the fact he'd reimagined himself as this, you know, artist that was found in the fucking woods by a bunch of Tartars who wrapped him in fat, even though the art world bought that until after he died, I think he felt really guilty about that still, which is why he got into community work, like planting trees and things. And that's something I can only speculatively say, but where I'm coming from is that there is a sense when you make that claim, there is a sense that his big picture worldview, like these massive ideas that he was really struggling, it's all traceable in the work, in these small daily tasks he was doing. Is that something you've considered with your work, of how your kind of overall worldview might be changing the mechanical aspects of your work?
In small parts. I think definitely, though, for my master's, you know, next year, that's more how I want to address it, how I want to approach it. Yeah, just always coming, trying to come from myself or that place, and then and seeing where that leads and building upon that, rather than because probably in most of the works that I've done, they're too small and specific to really be influenced that much by my work.
Yeah, and I mean, I guess in a bit of what you do too, being a lot of it being collaborative does negate some of those factors. But what about in your, even just your daily life?
Probably, I mean, definitely, but I'm not sure how I could speak about it.
That's a hard one.
Yeah.
Do the clap.
Yeah. I put my cup down, and now when you cut it together, you're just going to start drinking from it.
Yeah, we're going to have stuff shuffling around the table.
But it's going to look like the same cup.
Oh, that's true. We're going to look so COVID, I'm saying.
No. Yeah, it just looks like I was drinking from it, and now the tea bag disappears, and you're drinking from it. An empty cup. You know?
All right. So to wrap this up, I mean, part of what I'm doing is, so this is all leading to making a channel, YouTube channel, which is up at the moment, youtube.com/talkingdark. Part of the impetus for that is I can really see a lacking, at least in this country, of infrastructure for the arts. And what I mean by that is, you know, we've established that art making is a little more complex than it might be given credit for. What myself and most of my cohort, everyone that's being interviewed, there's this common thread of community being as important as the art making. Like, the art making goes nowhere without community. The communal side of making is far more powerful than whatever you make has potential to do in the world. Other than make a few bob, you know. This channel really is about creating a space for artists to express our ideas fully, you know, to draw out the research, the stuff that goes into the work, that might ordinarily just be looked at and kind of dismissed in the journey through the art gallery.
But I would just say that I think there can always be more of this type of content, like what you're creating. It's always, for me, it's much more interesting to see long conversations and explanation and talking through ideas than the very short, polished, edited sort of stylized version of arts. I think on the internet, there's a lot of good discussion, but you're always going to get to the end of it. So yeah, it's great that that's what you're doing.
It blows my mind that there's, in like America particularly, being a podcast producer is like a proper trade now. And like people go and learn about descriptions and hashtags and all this shit that should not be a fucking job, you know. It should just be lo-fi, but has all kind of worked out its own industry standards now. And it's
you can be so successful lo-fi, so it's kind of funny and so much money you've put into it. is that relevant or worthwhile? I think in some circumstances definitely makes sense, but for me, being consuming something, I most engage with people that do the work for reasons outside of it being viewed by strangers on the internet, but by lots of people.
Yeah.
And, you know, like, I'm just, well, this goes back to what I said before, you know, like, if I could make work and earn a living through it, but no one would have to pay for it, I'd be quite happy. And in that, if no one watched it, I could probably also be quite happy, mm. as long as I was getting paid for it somehow.
Mm.
Yeah. Because probably it will have an audience, mm. if that is the case,
mm.
eventually.
Yeah. I mean, I've said to you before, I'm more than happy doing this for a long time before anyone even fucking listens to it, you know?
Mm.
Like, I like the idea that in spending this time in uni to really not hone my craft, it's pretty early doors still, but to find a way of getting it done, you know, I'm very happy with putting 100, 300 episodes up before it catches any steam. I'm more proud of this work personally than I am anything I've ever done. Where I think it like does have legs in terms of income is, you know, I've always kind of had this ability that I can't quite recognize myself, but people around me always tell me, and they say, you can talk to anyone. Like, you seem to just get on with everyone we ever see you with, and you're always talking to different people every day. And that's a strange thing for me to try and accept, because most of high school I felt very isolated and thought I was a fucking loner. Everyone around me was like, are you kidding me? You talk to everyone, mm-hmm. like, mm. what's the go? And I think over time I've found in rehab, in kitchens, in band environments, I've not only gotten on with people, I've made a lot of close friends through that. And I feel like that could be a weapon in approaching groups, you know, like Cooper's Green's high on the list, but it could be anyone. And using discussion to try and bring some humanism back into the fucking world. I like the idea of I'm not a socialist. You know me, I don't subscribe to anything. But one part of socialism and socialist friends that's been influential has been uncovering the workforce, like celebrating labour and work that goes into making things. And kind of acknowledging the full spectrum of what it takes to sort of keep society going. And I like the idea of approaching groups and interviewing people from all levels. You know, if it was a restaurant, from drivers through the brigade up to the head chef and the people in charge of conceptual direction of the restaurant. Like, really tease out in a series, like, what that workforce is and how different people's thoughts and ideas shape the kind of collective body. And I feel like that's a model that I could take anywhere and find interesting stories.
Yeah.
Like, anyone has interesting stories if you just give them the fucking time,
mm.
which we never do anymore, you know?
I think that's definitely right.
Mm.
Yeah, I think that's a great idea.
Yeah, we got to the end of my list. We're just wrapping it all up now.
Oh yeah, I don't really understand what...
Oh, it's all key words, only I'd understand.
Mm.
So you're on to your master's this year,
mm-hmm.
heading back. Have you thought about what you... Because when you sent me a draft of a proposal. Is that the proposal you're going with?
When did I send it to you? Last year, a year ago.
Yeah, but that was for the one that didn't...
Yeah, but it was pretty much the same.
Are you able to, more for the people at home than me, as I've read your proposal, kind of briefly, what's the project about? How are you going to construct it all?
Well, I guess I like to start by saying it's in the field of post-humanism.
Post-humanism, yeah.
And then more specifically, nature, cultures, multi-species.
Mm.
Now, there's a lot of large words that come from These researchers that don't mean much to other people. It's about Australian landscape and animals and my connection to the environment and what living in a more living in a way that is respectful to human not being central to the idea of life. So valuing the relationships between all organisms, you know, from biology, there's like, you know, interesting discussions how, you know, even in the physical science, the sort of deconstructing of human, what is even human anymore when we're pumping just a collaboration.
Full of silicon.
Right. I mean, even pre, like, industry, pre-human activity, all the microorganisms and everything communicating with each other, bacteria, and then dichotomies and distinctions between human and animal. Anyway, there's a lot there. And so I'm also drawing from Ursula Le Guin, the author, and a specific work of hers, which was Buffalo Girls, Won't You Come Out Tonight, which is a short story.
That's right.
Yeah, and so that's set in Oregon in America. But it's only, I'm only sort of using it as like narrative structure. How much that's going to remain, I'm not sure. Because I'm basically hoping just to read a lot and draw a lot and travel a bit drawing and try and make and animate and make the work with all of these things in mind. Yeah.
Am I remembering correctly that it was going to be a synthesis of filmed media and animation, or is it just animated?
I mean, potentially, but I've tried stuff like that in the past, and it's difficult, I would say. I'm not so gung-ho on making like that type of thing work, so it might just be drawn, painted, digitally painted media. Well, at least if you if you do go over, you'll hear it.
So yeah, that's a good thing. So we'll know when to stop.
Yeah.
I mean, even just what I asked you before about how the big affects the small, like that's I'm not going to ask that to anyone else because that's, you know, now that I think about it, it's a really hard thing to consider. But we're already getting into that now. As soon as I ask you about your work and you're talking, it's like, oh my God, the amount of times in high school we like joked about how dumb the world is that they are, it's so human-centric.
Right.
And like we've always agreed that, you know, why don't dogs have the same rights as humans? Like, why is everything not equal?
Yeah.
Why does this still remain in such, God's been dead for, you know, decades now. Why is it still like this? And post-humanism too is just fascinating.
Yeah, I really relate to it. I don't hold much reverence for us as a species, but
well, it all goes back to the sanctity of the body. Like, what the fuck is that all about? God shit, man.
Yeah, I mean, it relates to so many different things. And I think a lot of people are, working, even if not consciously, at, you know, calling it post-humanism. Yeah, it's, as you say, like, in high school.
There's two, like, post-humanist artists that really stick in my mind. One is the goat guy. Have you seen the goat guy?
I'm not sure.
There's this guy, and I can't remember his name, but he goes out into the bush, like on the fucking Andes or New Zealand or somewhere, and he's got these prosthetic limbs that he's built. Massive,
right?
Like,
okay, I think I know what you're talking about.
That, yeah, he wears them,
yeah,
and it looks so uncomfortable in like him being so faithful to the skeletal system of a fucking goat. It looks awful to be in this thing, but he like goes out into the field with his goat helmet. And
right, right.
But the strange thing about it is he looks nothing like a goat, because it's all just like heavy gear to mimic the kind of mechanical movements of the goat. But he does that as like a, if I'm remembering correctly, as not reverence, but empathy maybe, to try and like align his thinking and the way he acts in the world. But the other one that really sticks in my mind, that always makes me think of you as well, is this guy who had a glass eye. And he decided one day, this is dead space, like there's a cavity here that I'm just filling with a ball of glass, I'm going to make a camera. And so he filled the glass eye with a little camera and put it back in. And then he ended up getting in trouble for consent laws and all that, once he started posting video as a kind of record of it, he got in a bit of heat.
Yeah, it's things like that, which is, it's not to do with the actual nature of him recording, because people are recording all the time. It's just people feeling weird about a guy having a camera in his head, I guess.
I mean, it's funny, just the gaze is enough for people. It's I tell everyone the story about teaching out in the field in North Sydney, and I would sit there with my copper, or students would sit there with their paper, and people would get really uncomfortable that we were drawing them. It's like, I'm not fucking Michelangelo, like, you know, not even close to getting your likeness. How about you calm the fuck down? But meanwhile, like Marianne was telling me, she was saying, oh, you know, kids would take photos with their phone on the train, no one cared about that, but the public would get really uncomfortable with students drawing them. I was like, that's strange. And then I talked about it to her recently to tell you about it, and she was like, no, it was a full-blown video camera. Like, it was a handheld...
Oh, right. Kids videoing people.
Kid, like, there was one kid with a fucking, you know, camcorder like you'd shoot a, you know, B-grade porno with. And then the other kid drawing. No one gave a shit about the video camera.
Yeah, it's so interesting.
The lady drawing.
Yeah. Because they're being examined. They know they're being... you know, traced almost, I guess, thought about.
Yeah. You wonder if it's going to flip, if people are going to become more comfortable with beyond human than actual, you know, human conversations, these more material moments, you know. Thanks for having a chat anyway. And
it's good. I'm looking forward to the interviews over the week.
Yeah, should be good. Should be good.
Very nice.
Soon. All right, should we get out of here?
Yeah.